Welcome back. Many thanks for staying with us on the program. You're still watching Super Done here on Super Screen Television. Moving on now to our conversation of the day. We know that just recently the federal government secured an ex parte order from the courts to prescribe IMN, which is the Islamic Movement in Nigeria, as a terrorist organization. And that has generated controversy. Some are saying it is the right step in the right direction because of the violence as erupted from the violence, from the protest by that group. Other people say, look, this might just be an infringement on their freedom. But what does this mean for the country? What is the implication of this? Because right now we have a lot of security challenges. There are people who say, look, the federal government has not, we have the headsmen, we have issues around other sects in the country that have not been prescribed as terrorists. Why IMN? So there are a lot of issues coming up from this, and that's what we're focusing today as we look at the federal government and the prescription of IMN. As we have this conversation, we have a legal practitioner as well as a gubernatorial candidate in the 2019 gubernatorial election held in Lagos. He is Ladipo Johnson. Many thanks for coming on the program.
Thanks for having me. Good morning.
Good morning, sir. Good to have you.
All right. I'm very sure, again, you're a legal practitioner, a politician, so it's in both capacities that you're here this morning. So I'm very sure you've looked at this critically as a politician and as a legal practitioner. I mean, when you read this news, how did you take it?
Well, there are two sides to the coin. The first side, as you said, is that people have freedom, right of association. So when federal government proscribes the group, you tend to wonder what's the reason behind it, and whether we're in a military dispensation. But they did it in a clever manner. They went to court seeking an order of court, albeit the fact that it was an ex parte order. Now, being an ex parte order, it will only last for a certain amount of time. Now, I haven't read the order of court, so I don't know whether it's for 14 days or 7 days, or whether it is an order pending the time where the motion on notice will be heard. But that tends to make me feel that they have brought the group before, or brought the organization before the court. Mm. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying? In which case, the organization now has the opportunity to come to court on the return date and say, vacate this order. We are not a terrorist group. What makes us a terrorist group? This, that. If it is the violence, yes. How did the violence come about? We were in a peaceful protest. The police did this, the police did that, and that. So that leaves that open. So the fact that it was through a court order, first I wondered what sort of judge or which judge granted such an order. That's from my point of view, I wondered why. Usually the court will say, okay, what is the emergency in this, the urgency in this? Bring the people before me. It shouldn't take you more than a week to bring them before me. Serve the notice on them, whether it is in the papers, we call that substituted notice, or if they have a registered office, which they must do, go and serve the court processes there and bring them before me, and then let's argue it out.
But I'm sorry to interrupt you. Isn't that urgency in the loss of lives and properties that we've seen recently in the country?
There is. So, well, as I say, the judge, I don't know what was put before him, what papers were filed before him. We didn't see the affidavits in support. We didn't see any of the papers. So, be that as it may, at least they have an opportunity to come before the court and say that this order is not proper, we are a peace-loving group, and there's no need to proscribe us. The other part of it is that one looks at it and says, oh, Well, government needed to take the step that because of the incident in Abuja and the incidents before that, it was a necessary step, or it is a necessary step, to restore some sort of sanity, safety to lives and property. Again, there's a wide, there's a lot of room in between to go left or right, looking at it from both sides.
Okay, now the essence of the prosecution came about the peaceful protests that turned violent by the Shiite group. And with what we'll see now with this prescription, do you think this is the best way the presidency can go to curtail the Shiite? Because there are different law orders that has been given to the presidency to release Al-Zaghzaki and his wife Zainat. Now with this prescription, do you think it's the best way to curtail the Shiite continuous protests?
No, I personally, in the given circumstances, I do not think so. But there again, to be fair, we do not have the intelligence in front of the president on his desk. We don't have reports from the DSS, from the army, from what have you. We don't have that. But as laymen, I feel that I don't feel it's a wise step. I believe that the problems that we've had, they've had problems in the past, and they have been managed, as it were. I don't know why things are getting out of hand. If a court of law says to you, you understand, let this man go on bail, and you continue to keep him, then it is only natural. Forgetting the excuses, Garba Shehu says the president is not empowered to release him because maybe the DSS, I don't know. Whatever it is, people, if they do not get justice in the courts, will look for justice on the streets. That's part of jurisprudence. We know that when we're studying law, when we studied law, we know that. The law, the judicial system, judicial process is so important because that is what keeps society sane. If people feel, or a group of people feel, that they do not have the justice, that they keep suffering from the people in authority at that particular time, then some of them may not be so patient. Some of them may take to the streets, albeit that majority of what has happened, we also started out as peaceful protests. There's nothing stopping them from taking to the streets if it is to demonstrate peacefully.
Was it ever peaceful? Because we know that this whole thing, he started in 2015 when they created a blockade to stop the car, the vehicle of the chief of army staff, Tukur Ratai. And would you say that that was peaceful when you start to block the road and say, look, both government officials and citizens can take this road because we're protesting? Is that peaceful?
Good. I was a student union leader. In Lasu, I was president. Students block the roads all the time. I'm not saying it's right. They block the road all the time. At times you have them, you see bonfires with tires, with whatever. Once in a while you see a burnt vehicle. Now, what is the reaction to that? What was the reaction by the army? Those on the escort of the chief of army staff at that time. What was their reaction? Did the Shiites fire first, or were they fired upon? See, there's a difference between the military and the police. The police still have tear gas and batons, and what we call koboko, horsewhip. The military man only carries his dagger and a gun with live bullets. So if he feels that his chief of army staff may be under threat, he will fire. Now, if the chief of army staff's convoy was blocked, then in a civilian context, if they want to be truthful and fair to themselves, he should have retreated and they should have looked for another route. If there was no other route, they should have retreated. Spoken
even
to the...
Even if he's going for
a meeting?
An assignment.
Yes, what assignment? Were we at war? Is this something that couldn't wait?
And you don't,
do you understand?
You don't think that that's sorry to interrupt you, but you don't think that that's a bad precedent?
No, no, it may be a bad precedent. It's a worse precedent, and that's why we're where we are now, when you have soldiers just shooting at civilians who may not necessarily have arms. Do you understand what I'm saying? I understand it's wrong to block, but the reaction was not proper, and it has led us to where we are at today. What the military ought to have done, I know people will say, a military man, of course he'll shoot. But we're in a civilian context. What they should have done was to have radioed the nearest police station, the nearest police whatever. Say, go and clear that route. The chief of army staff has to go. If you cannot handle it, then we will handle it. Something like that. You understand? But... because the way they will handle it, the military, is different from the way the police should handle it. As you saw last week, when, was it last week or the week before, when Boris Johnson, the new British Prime Minister, was on his way to Buckingham Palace, some protesters blocked the road. They blocked the road. And immediately, the police outriders came back, pulled the protesters aside. One or two other outriders went nearer the new prime minister's vehicle, and then they went through the gap they had opened up. They drove around. Not one person was punched, not one person was shot. Democracy, I've said it on this show several times, democracy is the most difficult form of government.
Boris Oladipo Johnson, you know that no one was there. But the federal government has said these protesters were bearing arms. They have said they were not bearing arms. They didn't have any arms, to be fair to them. But and the government has said they were bearing arms. Because no one was there, it's difficult to exactly understand what happened.
Okay, what was the damage on both sides? If I'm a judge, you come, you say your partner was bearing arms. You come, you say Precious was bearing arms. You understand? I'll look at the damage. That okay. Did Precious shoot any of your people? Anyone hurt? Anyone hurt on this side? Because people will, and that is the unfortunate situation we are in at the moment. When government agencies say, or the police say, or the military say, this is this and this are the things that happen, we do not believe them. It's a sad situation. What they say should be sacrosanct. But we've seen enough in this country to know that, it may not be so. Point in view, the unfortunate death of the Deputy Commissioner of Police in Abuja. The first thing I said, some of my friends said, the Shiites shot the police. They shot the Deputy Commissioner of Police. I said, I doubt it. You're a Christian, you're supporting the Shiites. I said, no. I said, that's not the issue. One, why was he buried immediately? The fact that it's a homicide, he was killed, the fact that he's Muslim doesn't matter. There should be a coroner's inquest. Let's know the bullet. Where was the entry wound? Where was the exit wound? As far as I'm concerned, it may sound reckless, I would rather believe that it was friendly fire. That it was fire from the police themselves. Why did they bury him immediately? Why wasn't there an autopsy? And then you say the Shiites shot him. If the Shiites were shooting, was it the one man they would have shot? If he approached them, I hear he approached them, would they shoot someone approaching them to make peace? Highly unrealistic. So, unfortunately, Precious, we're in a country that you cannot take as sacrosanct what is said by government, unfortunately. Ordinarily, we should say, yes, the police have said this is what happened. But I've seen enough over the years, through my student days to the moment now, you see, you'll be there, you know what happened, the report you get is different. So I don't believe that. I don't believe that. Neither do I believe that the Shiites are innocent. You get what I'm saying?
All right. But let's look at it now. The prescription has been ordered, yes, given by the Federal High Court in Abuja. But as a lawyer now, constitutionally, do you think that the federal government has a right to call for a prescription of the Shiites group as a terrorist group?
Well, as I said, look, the right, the federal has, government has a right to approach virtually for anything, approach the courts. The courts must now look at the constitution, look at existing laws, look at the public interest, etc., 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 and come to a decision one way or the other. Now, I don't know what was put before this judge for him to have granted such an order without listening to the other party. It ought to have been compelling. But I know that majority of lawyers have said, what sort of judge is this? Why do you give such an order without hearing the other side? But well, as I said, but yes, well, it's the same judiciary that keeps saying that as much as possible, we shouldn't grant ex parte motions except it's a case of extreme urgency. But as Precious said earlier, well, the death of people and whatever is extreme as well. So, yes, they may have a right. Sitting here, I cannot safely tell you that the proscription of the group would be unconstitutional or not. I need to open books and look at the evidence and what have you. But what I can say is that the group has a right to freedom of movement, the individual, freedom of association as a group, freedom of speech, all the freedoms. Now, as long as your freedoms do not cross over and begin to disturb other people's freedoms as well, you have your freedoms. Now, the government, in its wisdom, now says, enough is enough. These people keep protesting. But what are they protesting against? What is the issue? They are protesting against the fact that you have refused to follow a court order. And you say it is in... Look, last week, the Honorable Attorney General Malami went for screening again and said that I will disobey court orders in the national interest. Who decides the national interest? Is the national interest or the interest of the state what Governor Sanwo-Olu wants in Lagos? Is that the interest of the state? Or the national interest is what President Buhari determines is the national interest or the director?
What's your definition of national interest?
Well, the national interest between you and I may be different things. Now, again, we're back to what I was saying. democracy is very, very difficult. You now say to yourself, okay, this chap is a national security threat because your DSS have said that. They've looked at it. And we're meant to trust their judgment, right? Mm-hmm. So they look at it and say, it's a national, okay. Now, you cannot just hold a person under a democratic government indefinitely and claim that he wants to commit treason, or if he comes out, there'll be, you understand? You have to take those papers before a court. Now you can ask the court that because of what is involved, national security, whatever, we want it to be heard in camera. You understand? Not open. We don't want the press to report on it and everything. You could do that. But if you give them license, you are talking about precedent. If you give them license to just determine that Ladipo Johnson is whatever national interest, we'll lock him up in some cell in Ikeja for the next 3 months. No court appearance. You don't charge him with anything or what have you. Then you're playing with fire.
All right. I want to ask you again, because I asked you your definition of national interest, but I want to ask you what you would see as terrorism, because a lot of people have said this might be too harsh. The term terrorist, terrorism might be too harsh for this sect. So I want to ask you what's your definition of terrorism. But before you give us that, I want to let our viewers know that our phone lines are open. You can call in to make your contribution. When you call, please turn down the volume of your TV set. And the numbers to call are displayed on the screen. You can use any one of them. When you call, turn down the volume of your TV set so we can have a smooth conversation. And also speak respectfully to the issue. Do not cast aspersion on anyone. Do not disrespect anyone in the process. You can also go to our social media pages, different handles, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, to leave your comments, and we'll take them here on the program. So back to you, Ladipo Johnson. What's your definition of terrorism?
I don't have a succinct definition of terrorism. But terrorism, I would say, is an act or possible acts that either in the thought process or physically carried out that tend to cause mayhem in a way that would be totally destructive to society, and most times it has a political undertone. You're coming from an angle and you want that angle, you believe in what you're fighting for, and you want to force it down the throats of everyone else. I think it covers the different aspects of it. As I say, it's not a succinct dictionary definition. Well, that's my understanding of it. And if that were the case, I wonder why we have termed the IPOB as terrorists. They don't have an ongoing bombing program or situation. We don't see them trying to bomb the National Assembly, trying to do different things. That's one. Two, I wonder why the we all agree about the Boko Haram. They go around, they bomb and kill and maim with suicide bombers and everything. Sorry, we have a call.
All right, and we have Lawani calling from Mushi. Good morning, Lawani.
Good morning. Yes, we can.
Yes, I'm related to the manager about the legal system. I'm sorry that my colleague is supporting them. I think we are the students there in one who is never supported when they are in action. If you see what the federal government has done is very good, because we can't get them to fight. We're not giving them how we're going to be at blocking, giving people in, filling a promising political position, promising NYSC, NYSC person. So it's our barrister case. But man, see their behavior. It's unfortunate that this thing is happening to us in our country, Nigeria. Yeah, it's unfortunate. That is my contribution. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Lawani. Let me quickly say before barrister responds to you, let me quickly say that the federal government has said it did not proscribe Shiites. They have a right to worship as much as they can. They only proscribed IMN, which is a founding organization. I just want that to be very clear. That Shiites have not been proscribed, it's IMN that has been proscribed.
Yeah, Mr. Lawal, I am not supporting the IMN. Far from it. I am just trying to say, you mentioned the killing of the police DCP and the killing of the unfortunate killing of the youth copper with the television station. But Mr. Lawal, I am certain that you cannot beat your hand onto your chest and say that those two people were shot by the protesters. You don't know whether it was friendly gunfire by the police. And that's all I'm saying. That was all I was saying. That why the hurry in burying them? Yes, I know that there are religious beliefs here. But because of the way they died, there should have been an autopsy and there should be a coroner's inquest. We should have known what sort of bullet hit the two individuals. It would have narrowed down to a certain degree where the shooting came from. What position were they both standing at when they were struck down? These are the things that would happen in a normal, democratic, advanced society. Not that they package, they bury them, and we now all begin to assume that it was the people who were protesting against something that they feel that they have a right to protest about that killed them. That's what I was saying, Mr. Lawal. I'm not saying that I support the Shiites or I support the IMN. What I'm saying is that government hasn't done enough, the police haven't done enough to balance the equation for us to believe. And my position, I'm a Christian, doesn't mean I should be against the Shiites, but my position should make you realize that I'm really trying to look at things from a broader perspective. So that's not, I'm not supporting them. And it, as you said, I agree with you, it's a shame that this is happening in our country. Whether they are shot by the Shiites or whether they are shot by the police by mistake, it is a shame. And that is not the way the police should engage. That much I can say.
Okay, let's look at, we're actually talking about terrorism.
Yes.
Based on my colleague question.
Yeah, her question.
Now, we've seen the federal government come out to prescribe the IPOB group as a terrorist group. And now we're seeing that now with the Islamic Movement of Nigeria. Mm-hmm. And there have been reactions to this order given by the Federal High Court. And some people are saying if the federal government will prescribe the IMN as a terrorist group, then what happened to the Fulani heads, elders, and the clashes we were having in the country? Would you also want to say that the Fulani's killers are also terrorists as well, based on your definition of a terrorist or terrorism?
Well, I ordinarily, if we were standing in front of a newsstand, one would say, oh, they're terrorists as well. But it's difficult to say that they're terrorists, because the one, yes, we know that they're herdsmen, but do they have a defined group? Where you have Meiti Allah, who are now trying to distance themselves from the actions on the field, as it were, it's difficult to lump them up. But my take is even if they have not been labeled as a terrorist group by government, my take is that government still, to date, hasn't done enough. Seems to be, hasn't done enough to face them down, seems to be treating the matter with kid gloves. And I say this because we haven't seen or heard of any concrete steps that are different from what has happened in the past. As this thing has increased over the last year or two from government. Usually when something is not working, I keep telling my friends, I say, if the commander-in-chief, I'm talking about insecurity now, if the commander-in-chief were the manager of Chelsea Football Club and you are supporting Chelsea, you wouldn't let him stay till the end of the season. From the problems we've had in the security aspects in the country. But because of politics, certain people are not even willing to look at it. They're not willing to say. So I wonder, if you're commander-in-chief and you've been getting the same results, your people are being massacred on such, I mean, the other day, okay, that was Boko Haram. How many people were killed last week? You understand? And the chief of army staff is still the same. Maybe the national defense advisor is being changed now. You understand? Or a national security advisor or minister of defense or whatever. These people for a long time remained in position. So that means that the commander in chief had confidence in what they were doing.
A lot of people said that changing of the security chief
would not matter.
Yeah, does not really matter. And if I had to quote the statement made by the chief of Air Staff Mburota, he said the strategies against insurgency and tackling insecurity in the country is actually working. But with all this, do you think it would be right to change the security chiefs? Looking at the fact that the presidency have this belief that they are pulling their weight in curtailing security in Nigeria.
Well, they may be pulling their weight. And his presidency and legacy lies upon it. You cannot change the chief of army staff, neither can I change the head of the DSS. It is only Mr. President that could do that. Now, if he is willing to continue, 4 years is a very short time. This year is almost ended. We started August today. It's a very short time. If he is willing to continue to repose his confidence in them, saying that it is working, whilst sitting here, we know that things are getting worse, including kidnappings, and what, whether or not they are being kidnapped by Yoruba boys or Igbo boys or the Fulani herdsmen, kidnappings are on the increase. So if Mr. President is willing to say that, okay, these people that he's with, they're doing well, where we have a handle on the situation, then we can do nothing about it. We just sit and smile. It goes down to his legacy when he leaves. If things do not degenerate to the level that will totally bring mayhem in the country, God forbid. So, I would feel that if things were really being shaken up, we would have seen the effects of that. You know, when the president started, we had what we were calling what his supporters were saying, the body language. Well, the body language is not good. The body language is that, we're being beaten back for the past, say, year and a half to 2 years, but nothing innovative, nothing new. I agree that at times you take decisions and you make moves and you strategize in security issues, you don't want to make it public, right? But by now, we should be seeing the effects of such strategies and policies if they were working.
All right. Was just speaking with Ladigbo Johnson, who is a legal practitioner and a gubernatorial candidate in the 2019 governorship elections in Lagos. We'll take a break now, and when we return, we'll continue our conversation on the federal government and the prescription of IMN.
Sorry to cause impromptu here.
We have a call.
Ayo from Maryland. Ayo, good morning.
Good morning.
It's been a long time.
The entire house, thank you very much. Melipa is the cause.
Many thanks for joining us. Let's get your contribution.
Thank you very much. Please, well, my contribution is that concerning the that I watched the video. I also sent the video just now to you, I know which they are opening, about the man in Iran when he was commanding a parade of battalion with his flag and everything to destabilize Nigeria. He has the Navy, he has the Air Force, he has the soldiers of Palestine, a woman. So if you open, I'm sending this video to you now to confirm if it's true. I want to ask you, is it right? If the man is looking, is a Christian, actually seen that video. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Ayo. We'll look at your video and confirm for you, but we'll take this break now, and when we return, we'll be responding to some of the issues you raised. So stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Many thanks for staying with us on the program. You're still watching Super Dawn here on Super Screen Television, and our conversation we're focusing on this morning is the proscription of IMN by the federal government. And just to you called us earlier and you talked about how you have a video where exactly was matching with some people, but I just want to quickly give you this information. Is in DW, which is Deutsche Welle. They say Zakzaki founded the organization originally a student movement inspired by Iran's Islamic Revolution in the late 1970s. The Nigerian cleric convinced fellow students that an Islamic revolution was also possible in their country. The group's first reported march in 1980 was in support of Iran after a joint US-Canadian operation to save U.S. diplomats trapped in Tehran in 1979. So their first match, which probably you're talking about, was in 1980, and it was in support of Iran. So maybe that's what you're talking about. We've not seen your video, but just to confirm that for you. But back to you, Barrister. When you look at a lot of people, there are a lot of worries now that the federal government might be making a mistake here, repeating some kind of mistake here in proscribing the group, that a group could go on the ground and become some sort of a security threat and to the country. And do you agree that this group could become a security threat to the country or another? Some people say they could become another Boko Haram. Do you agree?
Well, it is a distinct possibility. When you have a group and they're out there and you can see their leadership, you know them, it's easier to handle, to control. But when you push them underground, then it becomes more difficult. Once you have a people who have a belief in a religion or in certain issues, and they're propelled by philosophies that they believe in, then it becomes very difficult. That's why it's so difficult to face people who are suicide bombers. They're willing to die. Your own policemen and us in society are not willing to die by for that. You understand? So it's very difficult. And I believe that the government must re-strategize, look at what it's doing, and try to face this problem in a more holistic fashion. Yes, there are links to Iran that we know well. The Shiites are linked to the Iranian country. The Sunni Muslims are linked to the to Saudi Arabia. And we know that Iran on the world stage is still seen as a pariah nation, as it were, a sponsor of terrorism. But I am not saying that Shiites are, or that the IMN is a terrorist group. But yes, there could be, there is a propensity, a higher probability that if they go underground, if they are pushed to the corner, then that could be something that could happen. And they will not lack for funds in any way. The Iranian funds will come in from Iran. That is public knowledge.
Now, let me get your opinion on this now. With the proscription of the IMN group, do you think it's a way that the federal government is trying to halt the activities and to a very large extent end their existence in Nigeria?
No, I think it's a way that the federal government wants to reduce their ability to come out legally and say that, oh, we're protesting this, we're doing this, we're doing that. Also goes towards trying to end what they're doing. I don't think the federal government would say that it wants to stop people from practicing their Islamic faith, even if they are Shiites, you understand? I don't think that is what the federal government is saying. But the aspect of the organized group, they're highly organized. Have you seen them move? They're highly organized. the aspect of the organized units or organized units, the movements, if they are proscribed, then when they're issuing orders out to their members that let's meet at so-so-so place, let's do this, then you can easily arrest them. That it's a proscribed group, they're trying to do so-so and so. So that may be the government's thinking, and that may be the way they're thinking that they can curb the growth or the events, the unfortunate events that have taken place.
And the Amnesty International has come out to say that in reaction to the order, that what the federal government is trying to do is to conceal the over 350 Shiite group members that were killed in December 2015, and they're also saying that it's a way of them to stifle their rights to freedom as citizens. Did you agree with that?
Well, there's a fine line. As Precious said earlier, it's not the Shiites per se, it's the IMN. There's a fine line between practicing your faith in accordance with the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria and having a unit or group that may be delving into other things. I think that is what the government is targeting. Now, Amnesty International has a point. You see that earlier I spoke about what happened when the when Precious raised the issue that the convoy of the Chief of Army Staff was blocked. It was in Kaduna then, wasn't it?
Yes.
Now, as I said, a convoy being blocked is different from, I don't know what's wrong with my brain now, from the Chief of Army Staff being put in the middle and being under attack. Give me a good English word for that, you understand? So,
under a siege.
Under a siege, you understand? It would have been different if that was a situation that they tried to grab him. He was, naturally, his soldiers would shoot. But if I remember that incident well, the death toll was high, the injury toll was high, because not only was there the first round, I think the army reinforced again and everything. So when you have such a thing, it leads to where we're at the moment. And that was what I was trying to refer my friend Lawal to, that it's a balancing act. Democracy is difficult. Even if you do not like what that person stands for, you can't stop him from standing in the square and shouting that, I don't like you, Mr. Johnson. I don't like you. You can't stop him. He has a right, as long as he doesn't become a nuisance. But when he's shouting and you just come there and start to shoot at him, then who is culpable? It's the government.
All right. I know you said that, because Blessed asked you about how this might be an infringement on their religious freedom, and you said, because the federal government has also said that, look, it's on IMN, not on Shiites. But there are some lawyers who say that at this point it's difficult to separate both of them, that it's difficult to tell and say, oh, look, this is IMN and this Shiites, but Shiites are IMN, and so it's would this not also be an infringement on them? I'm just posing that question again, based on this, that would this then not be an infringement on their rights to practice their religion?
Now, it's a good thing that government went to court to get the order. I believe Femi Falana, SN, is their lawyer. Now.
Yes, exactly.
Yes. So I think that it's a good opportunity for them to go back to court. They have to go there anyway. And say, look, this proscription order, all being ex parte, must be vacated. We are not a terrorist group. This reason. And if you proscribe IMN, you are touching on our freedom of religion, of association, because we practice our religion under the IMN. It's like saying, for instance, I'm Anglican. If you say you proscribe the Anglican, okay, that's Anglican Church, you proscribe that, and you say, ah, we're not touching Anglican Christians. You understand? Or you say, don't gather as Anglicans. It's a fine line. I do not know yet, because I don't have the papers before me. That's why I say they have a lawyer, a senior advocate, and I'm sure he can handle it properly. But you're right, your question is right. It is a fine line that government is walking at the moment, and it depends on the interpretation. I take it this matter will get to the Supreme Court. It depends on the interpretation given to it by the courts.
All right, what's the implication of this going forward? They have been proscribed. According to the IG, they cannot gather as IMN.
Exactly.
The activities are illegal. No. Anyone who also supports the activities, you know, is also seen as a terrorist, an enabler. Yeah. So what's the implication of this going forward?
Well, the implication of this, as I say, is that what the IG has said will hold water, except this order is vacated. This interim order, is ex parte order, is vacated. And I'm sure that their lawyers would immediately take steps to have that done. The example you just cited, if they call for, in the Christian parlance, you call for a prayer meeting, and they all go to a person's house in Ikorodu to have the meeting. They all happen to be people who are in IMN anyway, but they're Shiites, and it's been called from the meeting was called from the mosque, that go and see how we want to prepare for the Eid or what have you. Can the police now arrest them and say, you are having an illegal meeting?
So this is a tricky situation.
Exactly. So they will say that, no, we're no longer IMN, we're all from the same mosque. The police will say, no, you are IMN.
Well, there's also a call for the arrest of their members nationwide. So isn't that also...
Why should you just arrest them? Okay, they want to arrest them, existing members, because they're terrorists, right?
Now, finally, do you think okay, we have this last caller from Akota Gospel. From Akota, good morning.
The truth our country don't normally like to hear is that things are going wrong. Everybody will be hitting around the bush. Hello?
We can hear you.
Go ahead.
Hello?
We can hear you. Go ahead. If you can't hear us, just go ahead with your contribution.
Hello, Gospel, we can hear you. Please go ahead. Okay, we lost the call.
Okay, finally, I'd like to ask you now as we round up, do you think the international community needs to wade into this order? In one way or the other, do you think the international community needs to wade into it, either the United Nations or...
Into the order?
Yeah, the order.
No. It's the Federal High Court. You don't need the international community to come and wade into it.
That's the issue. And the country doesn't want to hear the truth. Mainly, the man that is asking question with the journalist here has said it all. Like, when the matter of security in Nigeria, the issue is that the man at the power has the right. Even is now the right time for him to change the chief of army staff and all the chief security chiefs, so that let's see if all this mess can stop. Because if they don't do it now, it will escalate. Telling us that the kidnapping and all sorts of things going on in this country. Before you know it now, it will go more than what we have seen in the hand of Boko Haram. Look at when the former president was on power, President Jonathan. When you saw the hands fighting on the wall. He moved and changed the chief of army staff. When the Jerika was there, see what how he did. But because of sabotage, they pushed him out. So let's try to tell ourselves the truth. The exact issue of the king has been there. Nobody in this country who doesn't know that Ezazaki and his group are terrorists. Not until federal government prescribed them as terrorist group. If it is not checked, the worst will happen. Thank you, my people.
All right, thank you so much, Gospel, for calling in. You were going to give your final word before he called in.
Yes, I think you.
You were answering a question
about the order.
Yeah, the order.
Should the international community. The international community will always look at what is going on, especially international bodies like Amnesty International and what have you. But basically, this is a federal high court order. As I say, the group can still go to court. There's a court of appeal, there's a Supreme Court. Now, whether the IG and security forces, as Precious mentioned, would now begin to start to arrest them without their planning anything is a different thing. Then we can say they are being persecuted if that begins to happen. But if they are being arrested, if they are planning anything that will cause mayhem and further cause insecurity in the country, then the fact that they're under a religious body or under a religious organization does not mean that they shouldn't be arrested.
All right, we've been speaking on the federal government and the prescription of the IMN, and we have someone who wears two hats, many hats, but two of them we're using this morning. He is a politician and also a former gubernatorial candidate, yes, of the I think it's the AAC
AMP,
yeah. AMP. Here in Lagos State for the 2019 elections, and also he's a legal practitioner, so we're using those hats this morning. Many thanks for coming on the program.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
All right, we'll take a break now, and when we return, we're wrapping up on the program. Just stay with us.